brothers and sisters. Let the church say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Lord, we just thank you. We just thank you for just being here. It's just sunshine. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. If you hear me slur just a little bit, my wisdom tooth is loose. It's all right because God is going to make a way. I'm tingling right now. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Father God. We thank you for allowing us to see another great, blessed day. We thank you, Father God, for just washing us white as snow, Father God. Cleansing us, Father God. Where we're sick, Father God, where they say we're sick, we're healed in the name of Jesus Christ, because you're not a God of sickness, Father God. We got to just hold on, knowing that you make a way where there's no way, Father God. Where we're hungry, Father God, there's people that's hungry right now, overseas, Father God, abroad, Father God, around this world, hungry, looking for another meal, Father God. If they call upon your name, Father God, you'll give help, Father God's time. There's people, Father God, that's in jails and prisons, Father God, looking for help, Father God, seeking your face, Father God. They need to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, Father God. You said there's people in the hospitals. We need to go in the hospitals, Father God, and share the great gift, Father God, you've given us, Father God, the great gospel. Tell them that it's going to be all right. Give them peace in their mind, Father God. Give them the comfort of Father God's people that's mourning right now. Somebody did not wake up this morning. Somebody did not wake up. Somebody can't change their clothes, shave. Somebody cannot lift themselves out of the bed, Father God. But you'll make a way for them, Father God. You'll give them protection. Put a hedge around them, Father God. You'll open the doors where no one can close it, Father. So we ask you, Father God, touch the people who's got a gun to their head at this time, who's got a knife upon their head. Father God, we pray for the people that's about to smoke one or put a needle inside their arm, Father God. We pray for these people that you'll let it go, Father God. Let it go, Father God. Let them drop it right now in the name of Jesus, Father God. They don't need it. Somebody's trying to commit suicide, Father God. Show them a better way. Send your angel charge over them, Father God. Keep them in their way. Lord, we pray these things. We pray blessings upon your word, Father God, that's proceeding out of my mouth, Father God. Let them not see me. Let them see you inside of me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You're never alone, my brothers and sisters. What if the world is coming around you? And also coming around me. What do I do? I just stand still because it's only a test of God. You can go and believe this stuff, take it like a grain of salt. What if the clouds are gray and the wind is howling? It's okay. God is about to rain blessings upon you. God is with you. What if the storm grows worse? Speak to it and tell it to be still. God is with me. What if I shall fall? God will pick you up and start you on your way. Why? God is with me. This is what we need to be saying. What if my friends desert me? It's okay. Even if your mother and father forsakes you, God is with me. What if they say things that's no good for me? Remember, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Why? Because God is with me. What if I cry out in the dark of night? God says joy comes in the morning time. Oh, that's a sweet word. Joy comes in the morning time. God's with you. I'm tingling right now. I feel like a giant goose pimple. Because I know those times. I know those days. And all I call out upon the Lord, and he was always right there with me. What if my days are over? God says he is with you until the end of time. Why? God is always with you. My brothers and sisters, I'm thinking about a lot of things. I have a scripture, and I feel so good today, like every day. Regardless the pain I might go through, regardless the situation that I'm in, I know that God is with me, and God will never leave me nor forsake me. And this is what I'm saying to you. God is going to be there, and he's never going to leave you. Regardless, he'll be in the pit of hell if you go to the pit of hell. He'll be with you at this time. I have two other blessed speakers that's going to be with me. I should have said this before, but I see them looking at me, and they got the big smiles on their face. God is with us. God is with them. God is with you. Call upon God where your help comes from. Speakers are going to come right after me. So I'm just going to tell you, this is a dynamic day to hear the word of the Lord. So don't fall asleep. Don't change the channel, because God is with us right now, and he wants to hear from you, to call out upon him if you're in trouble right now. Even if you're not, he wants to hear from you at this time. I want to go just for a second to Isaiah 61. I only have a couple of minutes, but remember, God is with me. He can slow time down. We'll get this done. Praise the Lord. Okay. Isaiah 61. Let's go to the first chapter.
First verse.
Everybody there say amen.
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 All right, reads like this. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and opening of the prisons to them that are bound. Okay, now that was coming from the King James Version. I'm going to bring it down. There's another version too that is the NIV. Maybe y'all are new, drink milk. You're not eating bread. So let's see what the other side says. NIV, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners. My brother, this is why we're here. My sister, this is why we're here. We need to be about our God, our Father's business. We need to go inside the prisons, the jails, the hospitals, the pulpit that you see outside. They're asking for money, work for food. Sometimes we say we can't do it. But who is that saying we can't do it? God said if you do it from your heart, you're blessing one of my little ones. You don't know what they're going through. Some of you will be playing games. The other people are really hungry. People really want to do something. I go out and do what I can do. It's up to you. Are you about your Father's business? Are you going to reach out and touch somebody inside the jails and prisons? Are you going to reach out and touch and go out there to ministries, or go out yourself and feed the homeless? Are you going to the hospitals? Are you going to speak a word to somebody? What are you about? Are you about your Father's business? This is what I want to know. So let's go back to Isaiah 61:1. Feed it. And go to John 21:15-17. This is when Jesus told them to feed my sheep. This is a command we need to be doing. We can go to Hebrews 5:12-14, 6-1 and 3. We need to start drinking milk. And then go to solid foods. We just want to stay in one place. We don't want to move anymore. We want to be inside that water that you see on the side of the road that has all kinds of rainbows on it. Don't want to get up that that old nasty water. Y'all know what I'm talking about. The water when it rains, it stays on the side of the road, it has a rainbow on it, has oil on it, and why do you want to stay in that? You don't want to stay inside that. Do you want to stay inside milk? Milk, you are a child of God. You're supposed to grow. Grow. You're a soldier in his army. You don't need to be a baby all the time. What did Paul say about babies? About thinking. You know what I'm saying? About acting the ways. Just like we need to renew our mind by the Spirit of God. Then you need to go, you know, be led, be leading the sheep. Psalm 21, 1-6. Pray to God the Father. Go to Ephesians 4:12-14. Prepare God's people for works of service. We are the people, we are God's chosen people. Go out there to speak to the people that's brokenhearted. We need to do these things. Don't look over your shoulder, well, he'll do it, or she'll do it. Let's stop playing with each other. Let us do it. Let us be about, oh, Father God, thank you. Let us do what God said to do. And then we'll be doing his will, not our will. Then stop them from going astray. How do you stop them from going astray? You don't want to talk to them. You don't want to talk to these people. This time I'm outside feeding the needy outside in the streets in Charlotte, and I go from 3 o'clock to 11 o'clock out there talking to people. They say I'm crazy, but I'm crazy for the Lord. So who is that? The Spirit of the Lord didn't give me the fear to go out there and help these people. God gave me the power to go out there and help these people and provided funds to bring out all kinds of food. I never brought out anything else, no hamburgers, hot dogs, no sandwiches. I brought them always a Sunday meal. It's not about it's about what the Lord has put in my heart to be about his business. Then protection. Look at this. Go to Matthew 7:15. Watch out for false prophets. Then go to Ezekiel 3:6-7. Speak about the watchman. Speak about him. We have to think about it. We got to stop playing with ourselves. We need to teach our wives, our husbands. We need to teach our children. We need to pray with them. We need to let God have his way with them, because this is how we be about God's business, how we are about God's business. This is what God wants us to do. God wants us. God put it in our heart to go out there and do these things. Why did we fake the funk? We can't fake the funk with God. God knows your heart. God knows that he gave you a free will to do your choice what to do. When you fail, you say there's no such thing as God. That's a lie from the pit of hell. There is God. Every time you fall because of yourself. Not because God. You have free will. Let God have his way with you. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
I don't know. It's a quick sermon. I'm just looking for this paper here. I got to get up and go because we got another speaker. And, oh, I got 5 minutes. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Tracy.
I was letting the brother come up there. He's ready to come. Hey, come on. Now, this is like the price is right. But anyway, truly, we need to be a shepherd, a good shepherd. It don't make a difference who you are. You know, it don't make a difference to drink milk right now if you're about to fall this business. God will give you increase. God will take you from level to level. This is what the Holy Word said. God said he's not a liar. You can't mock God. You can't do these things. God will give you increase. If you're sick, afflicted, or if you're going through a struggle right now, call upon the name of the Lord. The Lord will take care of you. It might not be that day, but he's a right-on-time God. They said about me, I had MS. I couldn't even move around. I couldn't stand up here this long. I could sit down for 20 minutes, but I had to move around. And then I move around, then I have to drop. My legs would give up. I had to sleep in the tub 4 to 5 days out of a week. Look at me. You'll never see me. They don't even know I have MS in my body. They can't. They gave me a spine tap, everything else. Right now, they can't. Realize they can't detect there's MS, there was ever mess in my body. I'm taking $5,000 worth of pills every month. This is the, I asked God, I said, Lord, why am I taking this medicine because it's getting high? And you took that from me. He said, I tell you to take this medicine. I said, look, if they said if I don't take this medicine, then I'll be in a wheelchair and blind or dead. He said, did I tell you to take this medicine? And this is that God. 2007, I dropped that medicine. Right now, there's not any mess in my body right now. And they said, it's impossible. There's nothing impossible with the Lord. There's nothing. By his stripes, I'm healed. I never confess I had MS. And when you confess out of your mouth, it's curses and blessings. Oh, I'm sick. I got cancer. Don't say that. I got this. Don't say. This is what the doctor said. You never say this. God, it took from 2004 to 2007. God said this. He said, you're healed. He didn't tell him to drop it. He said, did I tell you to take it? And right now, I'm not on anything. So this is how God works. I was inside the hospital before. It's all about me. I'm just showing you faith and believing in the Lord. God will take you and bring you through the things. He'll make an exit where there was no exit. He'll close the doors so the devil can't grab you anymore. This is all it is. It's a joke. The devil's a liar. Every time he comes knock on my door, I said, Jesus, can you answer the door for me? He said, right on. And you have to go to the devil, please. You got to realize this, my brothers and sisters. It's hard. But I pray right now that God will make a way for you and for you and for you to walk in your life and transform you right now in the name of Jesus. I hope you got something from here. I hope that you get and become this shepherd that God has brought you to become. He brought you in. He gave Jesus you to be in his flock. So therefore, if you're in his flock and you're doing what Jesus wants you to do, you're going to go out there and shepherd somebody else. Because we are the church. We are what God said we are. We are the builders. You know what I'm saying? Everybody wants to get here and be a wimpy. You got to stand up. You got to be a soldier of God's army. Stop being a wimpy. God wasn't a wimpy for you. God said, come boldly to me. You know what I'm saying? What are we doing? Oh, Lord, I hope. Don't hope, Lord. You said be bold. I need this. I'm not telling you what to get to me now. Just I need some help now. But I mean, you got to be bold. You got to answer, look, Lord, I need this. And I believe that you will provide me with it. I don't know what day, time, or hour, but you said in your word, you will provide. Seek ye the kingdom of heaven. Who's seeking God right now? Are you seeking God with truth? Are you believing in your heart? Are you swaying on that fence? What are you really doing? Talk to yourself. Take an inventory, a spiritual inventory in the mirror. Ask yourself, what's going on in my life? Why do I have troubles? What's going on in my life? Why do I have sickness? What's going on in my life? What is going on? It's all about you. Nobody else. God said you have a free will. Do what you're supposed to do. Be about your Father's business. Press on to the press. Hallelujah. I feel like God said, we are blessed. We are the children. We are the Lord. We are what we say we are. We are sick because we are sick. We have something because we have something. Because we spoke these things. We are these things. It's not of God. Children of God. Does God get God sick? No. Does his angels get sick? No. You know what I'm saying? Is he poor? No. Hey, I'm a splendid image of my Father. So you're a splendid image of him. What are you supposed to do? You got to walk by faith. I'm bold. I'm rich. We are rich because we're alive today. We're rich in the spirit. We're rich with loved ones. Some of them, you gotta pray a little harder for each other. Some are hard-headed. But anyway, my brothers and sisters, this is Dr. Reed saying, God bless you. I love you, but God loves you more. We have Dr. Tracy coming up next, and he will call upon the Lord like I call upon the Lord too. Bless the church, amen.
A shock now, God calls us to bring messages together. So, thanks. It's going to be a lot easier to bring all that. And to one he gave 5 talents, and to another 2, to another 1, and to every man according to his several ability, and straightway he took his journey. That's Matthew 25:15. Throughout your entire life, you've had these little hints of success and achievement. Since you've been born, you've had these little times in which you can say, you know what, I feel really good about this. Or I can celebrate the achievement of it. These little hints of success that start reminding you that really are an uncommon person for an uncommon life. Interesting. I read a story recently that said if you had triplets, if you were part of triplets, each one down to the very DNA can actually be different from each other. They're all born at the same time. No one will be a duplicate for you. God made this mold, and he said, I'm going to create you. So, in life, you have these things called competencies. In the professional world, they call them competencies. Mm-hmm. These are things that you typically do very well. Mm-hmm. You're good at. Okay, they come pretty easy for you. Mm-hmm. They can be different for all of us. Then you have what's referred to in the professional world as called passions. These are the things that we feel really good about. They get us up and get us energized. We enjoy them. Most authors will tell you when you have your competencies that come together with your passions and you mix them in with a need that's there. Max Lucado calls this the sweet spot. Mm-hmm. Ken Blanchard refers to this as a sweet spot. Phil Hodges refers to it as a sweet spot. God says, it's you. It's what made you unique. Y-O-U.
There you go.
Okay?
There you go.
It's made you different, and it's made you prepared. You've had an ability in you. But what's that ability for? Share a little bit again from that verse. You ready? Unto one he gave 5 talents. Unto another he gave 2, and to another 1. And to every man. Unto every man according to his ability. Mm-hmm. So he didn't say, well, unto some men I gave talents. Okay. He didn't say, unto these few, I gave talents. He said, unto every man, I gave talents. The God who put the sun perfectly in the sky, the one that floats the moon, the one that created the earth and the water, and you, exactly where we're meant to be, says, you're going to get a talent. Okay? He leaves no one out. But there is something in order to get this talent that you need to do. You see, this is an entire talk that Jesus gave. It's a parable called the Steward of Talents. we start at verse 1, we read that, for the kingdom of heaven is a man traveling to a far country, who called upon his own servants and delivered them unto his goods. So, scholars will tell you that the traveling man is Jesus. Okay. And he's leaving, but he'll be back. Okay. We know that story very well. He's leaving, but he's going to be back. So he calls upon his servants to give his goods to. Okay? Before you can get this talent, you got to accept Jesus, not just for the salvation that you've received, but you have to receive him as your Lord. You have to accept that you're a servant, and servants don't sit. You know, you like that. Servants don't sit. Okay. Wait, you ask yourself, yeah, what's the talent? I love to play on the words, sermon, but a talent, it's the equivalent to 20 years of labor. What did Jesus choose a talent to tell in this parable? Because he wants to show you how valuable it is. How incredibly valuable it is. That it's not something you take for granted or you put on a shelf, you know, or just a pair of socks. It's something so valuable that you want it. You desire it. Okay? But I also want to catch on here for a moment, too. He's delivered unto them his goods. It's his talents. It's not theirs. They have the ability to receive it and to use it and even to grow in it. There's two ways you grow in it. One's called directly, one's called indirectly. Indirectly means I have a talent and I learn how to use it around it. A quarterback who's good at throwing a ball has to learn other things around it, like how to scramble and read defense. Right? Okay, it's not good enough to just be able to throw a ball up. But then there's direct talents. And that's when you attack it and you learn how to do it. You go from good, what's natural to you, what you're passionate about, to great, and then eventually to exceptional. Okay. So if you want to receive the talent, you have to receive him first as your Lord. Okay? And all you do will receive the talents. Every man. But there's more still to that story. Then after they received the one who had received the five talents went and traded it and made the same. The one who received the two did this exact same thing. They went, took the five talents, put them into action, and gained. They took the two talents, put into action, and gained back two. But then there was one. He received one talent, and he went down and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. His Lord's talent. This one did it differently. Instead of going out and using it, he hid deeply because he wanted it's just between and I. I'm not here to share it with anyone else. It's just about our relationship. That's all. Right? That's all. It's just about this. That's it. I'm going to keep it. But as we all know, the Lord comes back. Okay? whole different sermon right there. The Lord will come back, right? After a long time, the Lord of these servants cometh and reckoned with me. And he said unto them to receive the 5 talents, came and brought another 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me, you delivered unto me 5 talents, and I have gained besides them 5 more talents back. And the Lord says unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, and I will make you ruler over many things. And here's something that is greater than that. Okay. Enter thou into the joy. There is joy with those talents. When you, that's comfort. That doesn't say easy. But there is joy when you use that. Okay. The servant who is given 2 talents, I say, the servant who was 2 talents did the same thing. Yes. He went and gained 2 more talents back, and the Lord said unto him, well done, good and faith-filled servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, and I'll make you ruler over many things. Enter unto the joy of your Lord. Okay? So, are these servants giving it back to you? Back to their Lord? They are. You gave me this because of it. I was able to grow it to here. Here you are, Lord, right? There's another phase that's still to come. Okay? Oh, but then there was that one who kept it right here. I'm going to dig it into the earth and not share it. I'm just going to keep what's valuable because I'm afraid I'm going to lose it. I might do unwise things with it, and I don't want to injure this relationship. Right? It wasn't bad enough to use it, but guess what? He blames who? He blames the Lord. Verse 25. And I was afraid and hid the talents of the Lord. Okay? Verse 24, he actually calls the Lord a hard man. Okay? One who created him, the one who molded him. The one that made him who he is. Gave him the ability. Now says, you're hard. It's your fault. And I was afraid. And the Lord responds, he answers unto him, thou wicked and slothful, meaning lazy servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sow not. Says, lazy man, didn't use the talent I gave. So what's going to happen now? Verse 28. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him that hath 10 talents. 2 great lessons here. One, if you're not going to use the talent I give you, I'm going to remove it from you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay. But there's another lesson here, too. Did he say the one who brought me back to 10? He gave me 10? But I originally gave 5 to? What did he say? I want to share the one that now has 10.
Okay.
Yeah. By being that servant, accepting because you accepted him as Lord, and he says, I created you with the ability, I'm now giving great talent, and now because you've done so well with it, I'm going to increase it even more. I'm going to give you great, great joy. I'm going to give you a kingdom. And I'm going to let you enter in my joy.
Yeah.
You know what it feels like to enjoy the same thing I am, to be excited about doing the exact same thing I'm doing for you right now. Enter into my joy. But what about our one that had the talent removed? Because we know, for entering into every one that shall be given, and all those that shall have abundance, but from him that hath not shall be taken away even to which he hath. So, even greater than what he was given will be removed. And cast ye unprofitable servant unto the darkness, where there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. A lot to learn from this story, isn't there? And thanks again for helping me, Todd. So, that we have this ability that's given to us. We have these talents that we need to grow in that talent. And school's a great way to do it, right? So, showing up here on every Sabbath is a great way to grow in it. Opening up your textbook at home. Yes. Here's the great thing. You can even get them free of charge, textbooks.
Okay? Yes.
And read it. Put time aside to grow in your talents. And then you got to go share it. You can't dig it. You can't say, I'm just going to read the Bible and show up on the Sabbath. And that's going to be my participation. Okay? No participation trophies here, everyone. Okay? For that, you need out.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And use that permission. Okay. I want to take a second and just put the talent again. So you have these abilities. What's a talent? I thought some of my questions. Romans 12:6. There, please. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord. He that regardeth not unto the day, he shall regard it not. I'm sorry, Romans 6. I'm jumping ahead now. Romans 12:6. Having the gifts differing according to the grace that has been given to us, rather prophecy, let us prophesy. Or ministry, let us wait on our own ministry. He that teacheth, on teaching. He that exhorteth, go on exhorting. He that is giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. Move on again. Let's head over to 1 Corinthians 12:7. To the right. To the right. But the manifestation of the Spirit being anointing is given unto every man to profit withal. For that one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom to another, the word of knowledge by the same anointing, and to another faith by same anointing, to another the gifts of healing by the same anointing, by another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of demons, to another divers kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of those tongues. We continue to grow. These are just some. He's not saying don't put a limit on God. These are some of the talents. And we want to make sure that we're getting those talents. We're putting them into practice. We all have them. Mm-hmm. Do you know what yours are? Mm-hmm. Just look to see what you've been very, very good at. What's been natural to you. Because this is not going to be hard for you to do. Don't try to be Billy Graham. Billy Graham was a great Billy Graham. You're not meant to be Billy Graham. You know? You're meant to be Eric Reed. Right? We're meant to be ourselves. Just be the best you can be, because you already have what was necessary to receive the talent. What are you going to do with it? It's a real pleasure that I got introduced today by Dr. Eric Reed. And I'm hoping today to say Doc King. Real King now. Amen. The part with, and I appreciate your time today.
And man, definitely a joy and a pleasure to be here this morning. My brothers and sisters, my Lord, definitely proud to see brother, you know, Dr. Reed and Dr. Swohart, you know, just seeing what God has done in them, just being classmates with them throughout the past few years, and seeing, you know, God use their talents and their abilities to serve and minister His word.
So, amen.
Now, that's what this ministry, this school is all about, making ambassadors for Christ. And as we're equipped, you know, we go out and serve in whatever capacity God has called us to. And we're so thankful to have this opportunity today. Yeah. In the absence of Dr. Slough and the rest of the staff, we're so honored to have this opportunity today to share with you all. And I guess somewhat show forth the fruit of what can come forth, you know, in this ministry. To raise up, you know, godly men and women who are able to go back and share the ministry in a way that we want to, well, I'll be in line at International who may be with us today. And all my brothers and sisters right here who are putting with me today, are definitely kind of an honor and a privilege. Not to be lengthy, but definitely wanted to share words of exhortation, some words of encouragement to the body. You know, Brother Reed and Brother Tracy here, they both, you know, tell some good aspects of the scripture. When you get down to it, it came about what it is, how we serve, you know, this whole relational aspect of, you know, our relationship with God, how it affects and what it looks like in our relationship with the world around us. So I'm going to just come today from the book of Hosea. I'm just going to highlight a few different aspects of the book. I would encourage everybody one time, don't personally go back and read it and study for it. Of the text, but today I'm just going to highlight some different aspects of it, kind of give an overview of the Hosea and kind of how that applies. And as I was just kind of reading and studying through this myself, I kind of found three things that stuck to me, you know, message was put in my heart concerning, you know, what was coming from this text. And obviously, as we read the text like Hosea, after you see, you know, the love and the fear of God, you see the, you know, restoration of broken relationships, and you also, you know, see, you know, the hope of the nation. And so, you know, I'll like to speak a little bit concerning all three of those points today, coming from the book of Hosea. So if you would turn with me to the book of Hosea, I'm going to start in chapter 1. And again, like I said, I'm just going to highlight a few scripture verses here that kind of just ties along with what I want to share today. Okay? But definitely encourage you to go back and read it in its entirety. Hosea chapter 1, verse 6 through 9. I want to start there, and I just want to read. And Sheikh began, this is Gomer, just to give a little background information. Gomer, the wife of Hosea, who was a harlot, she conceived after she had first gave birth to son Jezebel. She conceived again and buried daughter. And God said to him, him being Hosea, call her name Meruhamah, for I will no more have mercy upon the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away, but I will have mercy upon the house of Judah, and save them by the Lord their God, and will save them by bow, nor by sword, nor by battle, by horses, nor by horsemen. Now, when she had weaned Meruhamah, she conceived and bore a son, and God said to call his name Lo Ammi, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. So those are some strong words coming from the Almighty God. But as you can see, this is real, and their adultery with the Lord. Kind of paralleling that Hosea and his wife, faithful wife, Gomer. And I wanted to just start there, just in my own experiences and just seeing, you know, the state of our world and nation around us. There seems to be some of this type of brokenness, some of this type of falling away, so to say, some of this adultery against our Lord, you know, against the groomsmen whom we are married to, you know, as the church. We even see some of this whoring and some of this adultery that takes place. And so as I looked at this, you know, I thought, you know, wow, this is still a relevant word. God's word is always has a place throughout history, you know, from the past, the present, to the future. And so I saw this, and I saw, and I, like I said, I kind of just correlate, you know, where we are now as a people. You know, like I said, I could even look at, you know, brokenness of relationships in my own life, and but yet, there's still a hope.
Amen.
There's still a hope. And I think that's what we find out here in this book of Hosea. You know, we see the love and the mercy of God. We see God saying, hey, this is enough. I have a standard which I've called you to live by. And you are not adhering to the standard. As a matter of fact, you have chosen, you know, you have chosen not to keep my commandments, which you once kept. You have chosen not to follow after me, which you once followed. And so because of that, you know, he began to go in his children even. And so my prayer that God would have his mercy on them, and they would be his people. And that's what he to not just the family, but to the nation of Israel. thing that's a warning remains for us today. Warning. You see the love of God to these people. Upon the repentance, if we would turn back to God, if we would come to Him, keep Him too. So I want to read Hosea chapter 3 now. Hosea chapter 3. Verse 1-5. And it says, then the Lord said to me, go again, love a woman who is loved by a lover, committing adultery, just like the love of the Lord for the children of Israel, who look to other gods and love their flagons and their wines. So I bought her to me for 15 pieces. And for a homer of barley, for a homer of, and half a homer of barley. And I said unto her, that shall be that you shall abide with me many days, and not play the harlot. And you shall not be for the man, so I will be for you. For the children of Israel shall abide many days without a king, without a prince, without a sacrifice, without an image, without an ephod, without a teraphim. Afterwards shall the children of Israel return and seek the Lord their God, David, their king, and shall fear the Lord in his goodness in the latter days. So here, after God has pronounced that, you know, he might have mercy, that he, you know, would not be his people. You see here, God being merciful and saying, you know, he would even go back and buy them out of their captivity and bring them to a place to where they'll be back in his kingdom, seeking him and his goodness. And so he's speaking this as, you know, as a means of encouragement and a promise for the children of Israel. And it's giving them a hope. It's giving them a hope. And as we go back to, as we move forward to Hosea chapter 6. Actually, I want to start at the last verse in chapter 5 and then go through. So that's Hosea chapter 5, verse 15. Then we're going to go through Hosea chapter 6, verse 3. And again, this is the Lord just giving a call to repentance, so to say, to Israel. And like I said, we see God had been fed up with where they had come to, their idolatry, their adultery toward him. But like a loving husband, he gives them this call to repentance here, because he's, you know, his deepest desire is to be married to his wife, the church. Hosea 5:15, it reads, I will return again to my place. I will go and return again to my place to acknowledge their offense, and seek my face, in their affliction they will see me early. Says, come and let us return to the Lord, for he has warned, and he will heal us. Yes, and he will bind us up. As we see revivers in the third day, he will raise us. We shall then follow the Lord. He's going for his parents in the morning, and he shall come to us. Amen. Glaring the form of the earth. For he be the mercy of see the extended table. You see the, you know, if we take it back to the marriage relationship between Hosea and Gomer, you know, being this, you know, like this unfaithful Israel here. Hosea in a type of, you know, that God is playing here toward Israel. He's playing the same role toward his wife. Being there. Going back out of the envy of those who were pimping out, mm-hmm. having enough to go back and get her, and, you know, be able to have mercy upon her, you know, and given her an opportunity to repent and to renew herself again. And so you see the love exemplified in that. And so we see this brokenness of a nation, and we see this brokenness of a family, of a marriage. But yet we see the hope, you know, in between the lines of that as well. And I think we're living in a time where both of those things are constantly challenged. We see, you know, what's going on a national level, you know, with our laws, with what's being, you know, advocated for and promoted. And, you know, even so much so that the church has slipped into, you know, being so inclusive of every behavior and every, you know, thing that is now become politically correct, that we obviously see we see the fruit of that, you know, we see fruit of what has come, that the church being a place where one of the highest divorce rate is, and we see the brokenness even in the families within our own congregations and people of God. And so we see this brokenness in the nation, in the church, in families, but yet God said there's still a hope. There's still a hope for the nation to be restored. There's still a hope for marriages and the church to be restored. But the catalyst of that hope is repentance. If we turn from our way, if we humble ourselves, and so God is coming, you know, so God is speaking to Hosea, he ministered, and so Hosea is prophesying, and at the same time he's having to make these life applications in his own life, you know, to live this husband who was not too long, and that time an adulterous nation. Having the mercy of God, and you know, obviously that's what we desire and that we long for. Long to see the nation and long to see, you know, unified again. And we have relationships in our own life, be that a marital or, you know, broken relationship with our parents or children, friends, or whatever, maybe those brokenness. And sometimes that's put us in a place to extend mercy upon those who have, you know, transgressed us. And he's saying, so extend love, extend mercy. God doesn't want to just be a poor man and be ran over, that type of thing. So he also gives us to the children of Israel that the catalyst must be repentant. It allows us to have this brokenness in our own relationships, and we're in this place where, you know, sometimes bitterness and even unforgiveness rise up in our hearts. God says, you know, and sometimes out of that rage, even sometimes out of that bitterness and out of that unforgiveness, we want to respond emotionally. We want to respond in a way that would justify our own feelings. But mercy says no. Mercy says no, and the love God says to, you know, extend love to these individuals, to this group of people, to this person, to that person. And if they're willing to if they acknowledge their ways and they're willing to turn from that, mm-hmm. then you love them. You right. embrace them. Just like I embrace Israel, just like I embrace my church on their repentance. And so when I look at this, I'm so hopeful. I'm so helpful when I look at my own circumstances in my own life. It speaks to me personally. But then when I look out and see what's going on in our nation, you know, what's going on in our schools, what's going on, you know, politically, just the whole climate of everything that's going on, we can all say that, you know, more than we have been on the decline nationally for some years now.
Yes.
But even in the midst of all that, I still see sparks of hope as we meet here today, assembling in His name, advocating, you know, the righteousness and goodness of His word, and trying to make those things applicable in our own lives and go out, not sitting, but trying to be of this word. Inwardly also, and I read the text of the scripture here. Have mercy of God. Have mercy of God. Be the thing that you know the triggers in the heart of people, you know, in the heart of the nation, to turn back to. And see restoration. And as we read through this book of hope, we see that, like I said, you just really get that and that love and mercy I display. And you see, you know, all of the sins and nation of Israel going. You see all of this God giving love as a loving father. You see love to a nation. You see the love of a husband to wife extended. You see the restoration of those things. And one final scripture I just want to read because I think it's just a joyful scripture to read. A joyful way to end this. In the last chapter of Hosea, chapter 14, we see, starting at verse 1 and 2, and then I want to read there 4. Hosea 14, verse 1-2, it says, O Israel, return unto the Lord your God, for you have fallen by me. It says, Take with you words, return to the Lord, say to him, take away all iniquities, for all for the calves of the sacrifices of our lips. Number 4, I respond. I will heal their back. I will love them for my anger to turn with them. Next, I see the mercy and the love of God, which we know endures forever. And it's always available. The catalyst of that mercy being poured out and either in our lives personally or in the lives of, you know, within his body. Even the nation commit that the mercy of God is that way of restoration. I'm close with that day, and all those, you know, whether it be physically or here, you know, via online, you know, I thank you all for this fellowship with us today. As always, there's an opportunity to ask questions, so I think those online can submit any of their questions, and Dr. Slough can get back with you. But I wanted to extend the opportunity for anyone to add to the discussion today, or ask any questions before we close.
Nothing. Questions online.
Well, with that being said, I definitely appreciate everyone coming out today. And again, it's been an honor. of mine to fellowship with you all. It's definitely been a privilege and honor. Pray that we continue to just do the will of the Lord and use the talents that he has invested into us, that we can go back and minister down to the world around us. Again, thank you all, and God bless. I guess we'll close in a closing prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, oh God. Thankful for your love toward us. God, thankful, oh God, that you loved us enough to even give us the opportunity to come to you in repentance, oh God. So, Father, we thank you, oh God, how you've given us an example of how to love, how to be merciful. And Father, there's a world around us, oh God, who needs to experience your love. I mean, Father, needs to experience the realness of your love, oh God. And Father, yeah, there's still a charge for us to set a standard, oh God, and to be an advocate of your word, of your teachings. So Father, help us as we go out today to do that, to be ambassadors of you, of your word, Father, of those things that you have commanded us to do. Oh God, let us teach and instruct those things in our own family. Father, help us in our own life. Oh God, to do those things. Father, give us those opportunities, oh God, which we can share with others. I may, God, come in repentance to you. Have seen this wonderful gift of salvation that you've been through us through the Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you. We pray for everyone in this place today, oh God, you know, everything. You know, if there's a living, you know, oh God, help God, we bring it before you, Lord, God, to see you. We do whatever you need it. God, we pray God is the bad and try to inject truth in your life, God. We pray that. And as there may be opposition with that, God, that you will just continue to have mercy, oh God, and love toward them. Oh, Father, help us to labor, Father, be laborers of you. God, we pray for God's power in this ministry, oh God, as it continues forth, oh God, and bring truth, oh God, to the ear of many, oh God, for every student, oh God, who's come through, oh God, who have been equipped, oh God, your word, help us to go, help them to go out and to just that, be ambassadors of you. Oh God, we thank you today, and we give to you, oh God, as we continue, oh God, in our day, and then in the week to come. In Jesus' name.
Brothers, before you leave, get your own.